The probiotics as a tool for combating antimicrobial resistance, but since I do not work in that area, I'm just going to talk about some part of the work which we do. And as Professor Ganguly has said, I have to wind up in 10 to 15 minutes, so I'll try to be as quick as possible. So for the last decade or so, our group is involved in mapping the human microbiome across the country, and the reason for that is since the now in future we are looking for microbiome based personalized solutions, it's important to characterize the Indian microbiome as it exists. And the reason is that if we some of the slides I'm going to skip for the since we are running short of time. So the reason for this is the microbiome varies across the globe in different geographical regions based on ethnicity, diet, and biogeographic regions. And that's the reason if you have to find out India specific solutions, then we need to understand Indian microbiome in much better and a deeper way. So that was the driving force for this study. And I must mention here in this platform, the idea for initiating this work actually came up from one of the probiotic symposia, because this particular activity is happening for more than a decade, and probably one of the first such meetings I was present, and I was traveling back with another friend of mine. He is not in the audience today, Dr. Ashish Bawdekar, and we were discussing about probiotics and effectiveness of probiotic in Indian population. And he said that though everybody says, that time it was Professor Ganguly during his presentation or discussion made a point that Indian gut microbes are very different from the rest of the world. And then we were discussing that everybody makes this statement, but there is no published literature to prove that. So that was more than a decade ago, and that prompted us to initiate the study on gut microbiome of Indian population. And what I'm going to show today is outcome of what we have done for last couple of years on these lines. So this prompted our study, and then gut microbiome and microbiome became a buzzword, and people started talking about microbiome. Rest is known to everybody. So India, if you look at the India, it is divided into, it's the seventh largest geographic area and divided into 10 biogeographic zones. And this biogeographic zones also leads to tremendous diversity in the diet. As we go from north to south and east to west, there is a tremendous variation in the diet, and within a given pocket also there is an enormous dietary variation. So that, as we know, that the dietary variation affects the gut microbiome, and the modern research shows, the recent papers show, that it is not just what you eat, but how you eat also affects your diet. So in the Indian context, it is not just the consumption of rice, but probably which variety of rice, and also whether you eat curd rice or dal rice or sambar rice, that affects your gut microbial population. So that's a very important point. And we also have a very large number of endogamous groups. So all these put together, it makes a case that the Indian microbiome should be studied in detail for any future applications. So this point I have already made, so I'll not talk on this particular point. So we have been studying gut microbiome in health and disease. In the health, we are studying mother-infant microbiota, age-related differences, genome sequencing, and what constitutes a healthy Indian microbiome. In the disease, we have worked on diabetes, celiac disease, kidney stones, which Professor Ganguly was talking about just now, and inflammatory bowel disease. So I'm not going to talk about all the aspects. I'm just going to give you a kind of bird's eye view of what we are doing and highlight some of the important observations. So this particular study is presented in as a part of the poster. So again, I'll not talk much about that, but this was a study worth mentioning here, that it was conducted with the help of Dr. Sanjay Zuwekar, who chaired the previous session, and they have this Vadu HDSS area where we conducted this study. And the advantage of this area is that a tremendous amount of metadata is available for this population. So we thought that all the information which we get about the microbiome can be traced back to the metadata that is available with the population. So this study was conducted in Vadu population, and the one highlight of this study is we found a consistent age-related differences in the microbiome of this population. So we had selected from 5 years to 65 years, individuals were selected for this study, and we found a consistent change in the gut microbial population in this population with relative abundance of some of the genera changing, and which again has a relevance to the theme of this symposium, which is on the probiotics for the elderly population. Again, we use this opportunity to compare this data with the globally available data, and we compared this observation, this data with European, Asian and African populations, and we consistently found that the our population which we studied here forms a distinct group as compared to all the three populations. And we also compared this data with other published study from India, and we found that the consistently the observation that Prevotella is predominant in Indian population is consistent. So if you look at this study, the green circle represents the studies from India, studies from our group, and the other these are the studies from the literature, and this is most of the Hadza population and US population. You find that there the abundance of Prevotella is much less, and Indian population you get a higher abundance of Prevotella, and these are the other Indian studies. It's more clear in the next slide. So here this is our study, and these are the other Indian studies, and these two are the studies which have reported from the literature, and you can see that the Prevotella abundance in Indian population is higher. So I'll not spend much time on this. This study is already published, where we did some partial global comparisons, and we also looked at the share of microbiome across the population, across the three different generations. We looked at how the microbiome is shared amongst the males and females, and obviously we found that the mothers contribute more to the baby's microbiome. We also tried to look at both skin, oral and gut population. We tried to find out which are the maximum number of shared OTUs and what could constitute a core microbiome, and we again found that Prevotella and Megasphaera are the ones which is maximally shared by the population, our understudy. And I must also point out here that we were the first ones to show the presence of Megasphaera in the human gut. I mean, we isolated the first species of Megasphaera indica from the human gut, since it was isolated from an Indian. We named it as Megasphaera indica, because earlier isolations of Megasphaera were from ruminants or from other organisms. And then we also looked at the Prevotella population in the gut, and Prevotella is correlated with high fiber diet. So we also looked at our own data from clone library studies, and we found that the species of Prevotella present in the gut could be not Prevotella copri, but some likely novel species of Prevotella. So that work needs to be continued further to validate them as a novel species. I'm just highlighting the important parts of the study. So here I quickly show you the work which you have done on breast milk microbiome. So since the breast milk is thought to be a source of gut microbial population, the mother transmits the microbiome to baby via vagina and the breast milk. So we looked at the breast milk in our population, and what we found is that again the breast milk has high abundance of Megasphaera followed by Streptococcus, Staphylococcus and other genera. And again, if you do a global comparison, we did not find much difference between colostrum and mature milk, both at the final as well as genus level. And if you do the global population, again you find that the Indian population has a higher abundance of Megasphaera as compared to the rest of the world. We also did the source tracking, where we compared mother's microbiome, mother's gut microbiome and baby's microbiome, and we found that the maximum contribution to the breast milk microbiome is done by mother's gut microbiome, and as much as 68% of the contribution, 67% of the population contribution of Megasphaera is done by mother's microbiome. So the link between mother's gut microbiome and the breast milk is not yet proven. There is an intramammary pathway, but in our studies we could find that there is a high degree of correlation between mother's gut microbiome and her breast milk microbiome, and thus the hypothesis that the mother's gut is a source for breast milk microbiome is in a way supported here, but this is not a conclusive evidence. So we also do a lot of culture based studies. We used to do a lot of culture based studies, we have described several novel species of gut bacteria, and we compared their genome sequences and found that most of the gut isolates have higher abundance of carbohydrate degrading enzymes in their genome as compared to their non-gut counterparts. And we also looked at some of the isolates for their probiotic properties, and this is a study. I mean, you can see that totally 120 in one of the studies, 120 morphotypes were recovered, and this is the distribution of their genera across. This is their distribution across different genera. And one isolate we studied in details for its probiotic properties. This was a strain of Enterococcus faecium, and we did the genome sequences, looked at the genome sequence, and then we also looked at its probiotic properties, and it has various probiotic attributes. So many probiotic attributes like BSH enzyme, then fibrinolactic binding properties, and many properties which are required for being a good probiotic were present in this particular isolate. And this part is already published in FIG. And we also looked at the ability of this isolate. Since it was Enterococcus, we found its ability for producing curd, and it could produce a curd, a good quality yogurt, and maybe it has a very good potential to be used as a probiotic. So I think I kept with the time. This is my entire team, and different students have contributed to different aspects of the work. Collaborators, thank you very much.